tuned for more news after a few.
SCTV now begins its programming day. Yes, it's SCTV, beaming its 2 cents worth across the nation. Starring Joe Marity, Eugene Levy, Andrea Martin, and Martin Short. Television as you've never seen it before. This is SCTV. With tonight's special guest, Valri Bromfield, Dave Thomas, and Catherine O'Hara.
Together, for the first time, Barbara Streisand, Ruth Gordon, two women, two lives, one director. Barbara Streisand in a very special film, Rich and Jealous.
Rich and jealous. They called us rich and jealous, 'cause we had money and they didn't have a clue.
Barbara Streisand.
Why, we
Ruth Gordon jealous in the love-hate feel-good movie of the year.
There's no other
way. Could it be true? I'm my old college roommate. She ain't too bad.
And the older we got, the more richer we got, till the jealousy tore us apart.
The story of two women.
Just a minute.
Best friends when they were young. They meet once again, only now, one is rich, the other is jealous.
Come in.
Guess who?
Guess who? I can't just open the door and find out. I'm Superman, I can see through doors.
It's me, your old college roommate.
Mary, I don't believe my eyes.
I wrote a book. Help me get it published.
Oh, wait a minute. Go back. We were talking about my voice.
An explosive, made-for-pay-TV movie marking Barbara Streisand's directorial debut.
Tell me, why should we strive for more money when we're so jealous it ain't even fun?
Am I jealous?
You'll laugh, you'll cry, as old friendships are destroyed by professional jealousy. And rich becomes a dirty word.
I used to be first. Now I'm next. I want to be first again.
Get out of my limelight!
Your limelight? It's my limelight.
Oh, I'll write your autobiography long after you're gone!
Stand up.
I am standing up! Oh!
Jealous.
Ruth Gordon.
Rich.
Barbara Streisand. In a very special film.
Oh, no. Not another close-up of her. She drives me crazy.
Two friends. Two lives. One movie. Rich and Jealous. Watch for it.
Is Clara White, a very lovely on-the-loose lady who is back with us for the third time to debate a date she won on the date debate.
It just makes me want to heave, and it's even a little sad that what you expect to be the perfect evening can turn out to be such a nightmare made in hell. I am a lady, and I demand to be treated as such.
Clara won the date with debonair man on the go, Hugh Marshall.
Well, she was just bad news. You know, a woman has to accept me for what I am. That's all. That's all there is to it. Because when I take a woman out and I bring her back safely, that's all she should expect. What I do in between is my own business. I mean, anything else wouldn't be me.
And they'll both be debating tonight on the Date Debate. Hi, I'm Wolf Winkerlund, and welcome to the Date Debate. And now let's meet my co-host, noted sexologist Dr. Cheryl Kinsey.
Thank you, Wolf. As I'm sure you are aware, Date Debate is not just another battle of the sexes, but an open forum where our unlucky couples discuss exactly what the missing link is in their unsuccessful love connection.
Thank you, Dr. Kinsey, and we'll be looking forward to your remarks throughout this debate. But now, let's meet the unsuccessful couple, Clotta and Hugh. But before we start, let me just remind our studio audience that you will find a pink button for Clotta and a blue button for Hugh on the voting boxes connected to our computer. And it's by pushing one of these buttons after the debate that you decide the winner. That's gotta be fun. And we'll be right back to play the Date Debate after these important messages.
Hi, I'm Count Floyd.
And I'm Woody Tobias Jr.
And welcome to Scary Previews.
Later tonight on SCTV.
I love New York. It's exciting. It pulsates. It's my kind of town. But something happened last night that really turned my head around. I was lying in bed really feeling good about myself when all of a sudden I hear this scream outside. I ran to the window to see what was happening. And I see a gang of ruffians mugging this old lady. It was brutal. I was going to yell for help, but then I realized the whole neighborhood was already watching. And they were laughing.
Call the cops, I screamed.
Then this guy leans out of the window and says, yeah, wait a few minutes, we're having too much fun. They left a poor woman to suffer because they were having too much fun. Now who's to blame for this, huh? You? 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 I know it wasn't me. So it must have been the rest of you out there. Blood is on your hands. The ball is in your court. Now let's see you run with it.
Calvin Klein Jeans.
Hello. You know, I heard a lot of people say they can't tell the difference between sleuth and death trap. Well, I find that patently absurd and a little insulting. First of all, I played two totally different characters. In sleuth, I played a character whose voice and mannerisms were more like this. And in death trap, I played my author character, whose voice was, well, more like this. And if that's not enough for you, I mean, take a look at the sets. Totally different Tudor-type drawing rooms. In one, the entrance to the library was way over there on stage right. And in the other, I think it was Death Trap, the library was all the way over the other side of the stage, stage left. All right, similar furnishings are decorated, granted, but a totally different layout. And if you can't tell the difference between Lord Olivier and that other chap, what's the one? The one who played Superman. What's his name? Reeves. Christopher Reeves. If you can't tell the difference between those two, well, then God bloody well help you.
No, that's not it. You know, I think might be confusing people. Maybe it's that they were both plays, mystery and intrigue plays, what got made into movies. And then, of course, I'm in both of them. That could be it. Wait a minute. I remember. My agent made the deal on Death Trap before I even read it. Then when I read it,
I realized it was the same bloody movie as Sleuth. It was just Sleuth without Diane Cannon. How am I going to get out of this? People have seen them both. They've both been released. They're complaining. I know. I need another one. Exactly like Sleuth and Death Trap. That takes place in a living room. Then I can say that it was a trilogy. That it was planned from the very beginning, like George Lucas. People will buy that. They love Lucas. Tom, get that bastard Neville on the phone. Tell him I gotta talk to him. You wait here. I got an idea for my next movie. Tom!
And now, it's time to play The Date Debate.
We're gonna cut! No! Don't vote! Don't vote! Ladies and gentlemen, there's no reason to vote just because the risers collide. Ugh. Okay. We'll begin the debate with Clara White. And Hugh, as you know, we'd like you to leave the stage and go to the isolation area.
Right. Whereabouts is that?
That would be backstage. Long walk for Hugh. Hugh! Hugh! Come back! Hugh! Can you hear me, Hugh?
I'm getting static here. You're cutting out.
Well, monkey with the rabbit ears, Hugh. Can you hear me now?
It's not helping much.
Perhaps if he uses some tinfoil, it will help with the reception.
Good idea. Hugh! Dr. Cheryl Kinsey suggests that if you use some tinfoil, it might help with the reception.
All right, I'll give it a shot.
Okay, Clara White, the floor is all yours. Step up to the podium and let's hear your half of the story as we begin the date debate.
As you know, I was very excited to be on... As I was very excited to win a date on the date! I was there... Thank you. As you know, I was very excited to win a date on the date debate because Hugh has a certain animal magnetism which attracts me, and he's an entrepreneur and all, and I really thought that it was going to work out. Oh, but no. Hugh Marshall did not speak one word to me the whole evening. Do you believe it? Not one word. Nothing passed between... It was very human. The fact that he did not speak was very...
That's it. Cry. Cry your eyes out on television, you spoiled brat.
That's the first time I've ever had that guy talk to me. Do you believe it? Those are the first words he's ever spoken to me, Dr. Kinsey.
Everything you said tonight has been a lie.
Hugh, you know the rules. No talking in the isolation booth. Now, I'm afraid I'm going to have to penalize you 1 minute off your debate time.
I don't care. I don't need much time to say what I got to say.
I am not lying. He never spoke to me. And almost everywhere we went, he had the nerve to invite 5 or 6 people to join us.
Very interesting. And did you service all of them?
I certainly did not.
Oh, you prefer multiple... orgasms with one partner?
Dr. Kinsey, the man did not speak to me.
Well, you have to be more aggressive, dear. Sometimes a man has to be physically stroked before he can express himself.
I know what a man needs, but I cannot perform unless I am verbally stimulated. Oh.
Thank you, Clara. Your time is up. Now it's Hugh's turn to come out and tell his side of the story, and Clara, as you know, you must take Hugh's place in the isolation area on the date debate.
Hi, Clara. Hi, Clara. I'm talking to you. You enjoying it now?
Yeah.
I'm talking now. You enjoying it? Yeah.
Hugh!
You love it. You're getting turned on because I'm talking. I'm talking to you.
Are you? Congratulations, you. You're getting turned. You've just lost yet one more minute of your debate time. Hugh Marshall, you have 1 minute. You may begin.
See, that's exactly what he was like. That's the way he is.
Hugh, you only have 40 seconds remaining.
Oh, you can say what you like. You can't get him to talk.
Lotta, please be quiet. You've had your time, dear. Hey, don't you forget the new home version of the date debate. It's available at department stores everywhere. It's a lot of fun, and it makes a super gift, too.
You're wasting precious time, Hugh. I don't understand, Hugh. Why did you agree to come on the date debate?
Hugh, your time is up.
Hey, Dr. Kinsey.
Floyd, you may leave the isolation area and please come into the set. All right, Dr. Kinsey. May you share some of your thoughts on the debate?
Yes, well, thank you. As I see it, the young lady is hot to trot, but without a little verbal intercourse to set her rhythm in motion, she'd be like a vegetarian hot dog. No wiener. Mr. Marshall, on the other hand, appears to speak more eloquently with his bodily parts. But any prying into his private affairs turns his manhood into a mute point.
Thank you for your thoughts, Dr. Kinsey. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Cheryl Kinsey. Isn't she tasty? And now it's time for you, the studio audience, to decide the winner of the debate. Ladies and gentlemen, use your computer and please vote.
Lotta White wins!
Lotta, you've played the game before, and as you know, you have an option. You can try your luck again with Hugh, or you can spin the wheel of romance and pick a brand new date on the date debate. Now, Hugh, we're going to have to ask you to return to the isolation area while Clara makes her decision. The decision, young lady, belongs to you. Clara, what is your decision?
Well, Wolf, the only reason I might date Hugh Marshall again is as punishment for dating him the first time. But then I'd have to date him again to punish myself just for dating... No. Wolf, I'm going to go for the wheel of romance.
All right! Yeah! Yeah!
And now it's time to spin the wheel of romance, which, of course, is located across the hall in Studio B. So, Clara, follow me. And studio audience, you'll be able to watch on the monitors.
Thank you. Clara, as you know, there are 10 eligible bachelors on our wheel, and you have up to 3 spins to determine your date. Are you ready?
I think so.
Give it a spin. You have landed on James Sellick, a 34-year-old neurosurgeon who loves windsurfing and stimulating conversation.
So do I. But I don't know. I wouldn't know what to talk about with the doctors.
Oh. So you're willing to forfeit your date with Jim for another try?
That's correct, Walt.
Go for it, Red. Come up with Peter Humphrey. Pete is 22 years old and is a rock singer who has just signed a recording contract with a major label.
Gee, he is cute. And I do love musicians. I don't know, I seem to be on a lucky streak here. I think I'm going to go for the 3rd spin.
Let's see you do it. I want a date with Otis Fluker.
Oh, no,
a plumber's apprentice who loves plumbing and swimming.
Oh, no,
Otis is currently unemployed, but he has high hopes for working in the near future. Otis, get out here! Now you two dance while I tell everybody where you'll be going. You'll be dropped off by helicopter on a private island in northern Manitoba, where you'll spend 4 luxurious weeks in complete privacy. No telephones, no television, just you and your date. We'll be seeing you in 4 weeks, I believe, and we'll be seeing you, hopefully, next week, when you join us for the date debate.
This season on The Lottery, see someone who isn't anybody become somebody.
Oh, Mimi.
Are you Perini Scleroso? Perini Scleroso? I have here a check for $1 million.
Oh, little dolly.
$1 million. Can you imagine that much money?
Can you? Can who?
You won the lottery.
Oh, see, not the sodomy.
Sodomy? No, lottery. Lottery. No, the lottery. Look, you have won $1 million.
Oh, little dolly.
$1 million. Do you... What are you... Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You... Are you Perini Scleroso?
Huh?
You are Perini Scleroso.
Huh?
You won the... Look, check. Yeah. $1 million. No, no. Oh. You are a stupid woman.
Yeah, stupid woman.
Stupid woman.
Stupid woman.
Stupid.
Okay.
Watch for the lottery. Who knows? Maybe you'll be next.
Sometime on hot summer nights like this in South Carolina, you have a problem with mosquitoes. Not now.
I had a real one on my arm.
You're supposed to wait till I come to the part in the script.
What am I supposed to do? Let him suck me dry like a vampire? I had a real one on my arm.
Oh, you're supposed to wait till I come to the part and then you hit a fake mosquito on your arm.
Okay, I'll do it again.
Can't do it again. Everybody knows you're going to hit a fake mosquito on your arm. You always do this to me. You always ruin TV commercials for me. I hate you.
You go to hell. You go straight to hell now, here.
Sometimes when you have a problem with mosquitoes on hot summer nights, you don't need to know more. Just call Skidderitter. They send a man on over, and he'd take a secret compound, and he'd hide it somewhere in your house. And even your husband don't know where it is. Even you don't know he'd been in your house.
You know, one year, Skeeter's got so bad in his house, my daddy shot himself. Right here.
I don't believe you gotta talk about that.
I ain't gonna talk about it. I just thought they'd want to know.
If you got something in your house you want to get rid of, just call Skeeter Ritter.
You talking about me? You talking about me?
Oh. I believe it's time to go inside.
Next month, Rockin' Mel's Lurup takes an acid flashback to the 60s.
Oh, dig it, man. And what's your bag? What you seen?
Well, I'm into love, into making things happen. I'm into the concept of oneness and being.
Well, that must keep you pretty busy.
Full-time gig.
I'm Count Floyd.
And I'm Woody Tobias, Jr.
And welcome to Scary Previews. Now, on this show, Woody and I are going to be reviewing some recently released films that promise you to be scary. Well, we'll tell you whether they're chillers or whether they're clinkers.
Whether they're ghoulish or whether they're foolish.
That's right. Whether they're tinglers or whether they're stingers.
I think that last one was a bit of a reach, Count Floyd. Now, kids, the whole purpose of this show is to make sure you get the most out of your entertainment dollars. So if we can direct you in that regard, then I guess what we're doing on the show is, what's the word? This is ridiculous. What we're doing is,
All right, well, look, let's take a look at the first clip.
Worthwhile.
So now, our first clip is a recently released film. Now, it's a remake of that classic Spencer Tracy film called Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
And you know, Count Floyd, that Tracy and myself are the only two people I know of that attempted that Jekyll and Hyde transformation sans makeup.
Well, Woody, what would you say was the main difference between your version and Spencer Tracy's version?
Well, my version didn't get released, for one thing.
All right, well, this one was released, and we're going to take a look at a clip at it from it right now. And this is starring Scott Baio in the lead. He plays the Spencer Tracy part, and he's going to be Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. He's going to make the transformation in this scene without makeup, just using his acting ability.
Well, let's take a look at Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, starring Scott. Now, is it Bio or is it Bale?
Bio.
Scott Bale.
Was that, huh? Hey, talk about acting transformations, eh? I'll tell you one thing, that Scott Baio's no Spencer Tracy.
He's not even a Dick Tracy. I can't recommend that film at all whatsoever.
Well, I agree with you, Woody. 100%. I didn't like the film either. And so that's two no votes for Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Our next clip is from Cujo 2, a sequel to the very excellent Cujo.
Well, I saw the original Cujo, and I myself thought it was very flat.
I agree.
Wait a minute. Just a minute ago, you said you thought it was excellent.
No, I don't think I did.
Yes, you did. A few minutes ago, you said... Yes, you did.
I don't think so.
You said it was excellent.
I did not.
Did too.
I did.
Did.
Liar.
All right, forget it. Look, we'll take a look at a film clip now of Cujo 2. This is a trailer from the movie.
Easy boy.
Ah! I warned you not to come waltzing in late like this without calling me. What the hell do you think you are? I clean the house. I wash your clothes. And you don't do anything. And I have to spend time with your family. I hate your family. Don't you dare ignore me when I'm talking to you. When I'm talking to you, I expect you to listen. Don't you bring that dog around here. You don't do dishes. You don't do anything in the house. I'm going to break up the doggy door.
Oh, that's scary stuff. Did you see that foam coming out of her mouth?
And the dog and everything. That film scared the willies out of me, Captain Floyd. I recommend it highly indeed.
All right, then. That's two recommendations, because I liked it also. That's Cujo 2. Boy, we think it'll scare the pants off of you.
And now, it's time for...
The Stiff of the Week! That's right. Each week, Woody Tobias Jr. and myself pick the two worst movies we saw, the Stiffs of the Week, and we review them. Now, Woody, what was your Stiff of the Week?
Well, Count Floyd, my Stiff of the Week was another George Romero spinoff of Night of the Living Dead. It's called The Night of Living Dangerously, and it's a film about a guy who hooks up with Indonesian midgets who turn into zombies. Actually, a very interesting premise. I quite enjoyed it.
But why did you pick it as a Stiff of the Week?
I don't know. What was your Stiff of the Week, Count Floyd?
Well, my Stiff of the Week, the absolutely worst movie I saw this past week, is a movie that has you presently appearing in it, Bruno.
Oh, no.
That's right, The Mysterious Disappearance of Dr. Tong in 3D.
I knew that wouldn't get by you.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, Bruno, but I'm going to have to slam you on this one. Oh, all right, let's take a look at a clip now from The Mysterious Disappearance of Dr. Tong, starring Woody Tobias Jr.
Boy, what a mistake. Dr. Tong! Dr. Tong, where are you? Dr. Tong, it's me, Bruno. I know you're in here somewhere. Thank you. another dog. Doctor. Doctor Doug. Are you there?
Oh, that's bad. Bad.
Even I have to admit it's quite embarrassing.
Oh, buddy, I want to ask you a question. Why would you do a movie like that?
I fell in love with the script.
Wait a minute. You wrote the script.
That's right, Count Floyd, I did. But I think it all got buggered up. Where the problem was in the direction.
Who directed it?
I did. But I liked my script, but I didn't like my direction too much.
Yeah, well, neither did I, to be honest with you. That thing was over 2.5 hours. It was just a rambling. You're looking for Dr. Tang. Didn't it, you know, do you get monotonous?
No, not at the time. But what I was going for was a quality that... can you believe I'm a critic? Samuel Beckett type thing. What's the word?
I don't know.
Oh.
I can't help you.
I can't believe this.
All right, well, look, for Woody Tobias Jr., this is Count Floyd saying be sure to tune in next week for Scary Previews. Oh!
Existential.
What?
Existential.
What's existential?
What I was going for in the direction of it. Existential. I don't think I got it, but... always worth going for.
Join Brock Linehan on Stars in One when his guest will be Bob Hope.
Do you not feel that the alienation of the youth that took place during that war for you has been a youth market you were never able to recapture and therefore led to you retiring from films in 72 with the exception of the Frank Oz participation?
You know, You have a way of asking a question that makes you forget what it's all about by the time you get to the end. When you stop talking, it's like walking to the edge of a cliff. I have no idea what you just asked. But something about Vietnam. Yeah, that bummed me out. I blame the whole thing in Vietnam on the French. They've been weasels from day one. I did Paris Holiday with Fernandel, and I found out just what kind of weasels the French are, you know. They may love Jerry Lewis, but I don't have a high regard for them at all.
Dalton Trumbo.
That's next month on Stars in One.
Yeah.